Assalamu alaikum, Ustadh.
Assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you doing?
Alhamdulillah, I'm very well.
Alhamdulillah. Thank you for joining us.
Jazakallah khair for having me.
We have you on Inspiring Ikhwa. I only have a few questions with you today. The first question is, what is the key to your happiness? What is the key to happiness, rather?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He's the one who created us, and He's the one who created the whole universe. And Allah Azza wa Jal, He knows what will make us happy, what will allow us to attain happiness. And that happiness, Allah Azza wa Jal, He specifies in the Quran, He tells us what it is. Allah Azza wa Jal says, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً. Whoever does righteous deeds, male or female, whilst they are a believer, we shall allow them to live a happy life. The key to the happiness is iman and righteous deeds. Mm-hmm. That we believe in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, that we worship Allah azza wa jal, that we are fulfilling our purpose of life. The more we fulfill our purpose of life, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala grants us more happiness. And the more distant we become from the purpose of that Allah created us for, then we will live a difficult life, perhaps full of hardships and misery. Because Allah azza wa jal tells us the opposite, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى. Whoever turns away from remembrance, from the guidance of Allah, from the religion of Allah, from that which Allah created him for, that purpose of life, which is to worship Allah, then they shall have a difficult life, and they shall be resurrected on the day of judgment blind, right? A miserable life due to that. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala knows what God will grant us happiness. That's why the poet, he says, وَلَسْتُ أَرَى السَّعَادَةَ جَمْعَ مَالٍ وَلَكِنَّ التَّقِيَّ هُوَ السَّعِيدُ وَتَقْوَ اللَّهِ خَيْرُ الزَّادِ ذُخْرًا وَعِنْدَ اللَّهِ لِلْأَتْقِيَاءِ مَزِيدُ. He says that I do not see that happiness, it is accumulating a lot of wealth. People tend to think materialistic things are a source of happiness. La. But وَلَكِنَّ التَّقِيَّ هُوَ السَّعِيدُ, rather the God conscious, the one who is attached to Allah, the one who worships Allah, the one who fears Allah, the one who does that which pleases Allah, he is the happy one, the content one. وَتَقْوَ اللَّهِ, and the God consciousness of Allah and the fear of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is the best provisions that one can take. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is prepared for those who have that God consciousness a greater reward in the hereafter. So that is the key to happiness. Now,
subhanallah. And you know, nowadays a lot of the brothers, you know, the younger brothers or younger sisters who have the exposure on social media, and you know, we all have access to social media now. When we go on it, we see brothers making millions, you know, someone's making millions, someone just bought a house, someone's got a car. What can we do as Muslims to find contentment with this, and how can we battle this?
Very good question. Having worldly matters, materialistic things, there's nothing wrong with that Islamically. If a person is very wealthy, there's nothing wrong with that. Rather, Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, from the best things that an individual can have, it is wealth that he uses for good things that is given to a righteous servant. Why? Because the righteous servant will use the wealth in order to obey Allah and to do that which pleases Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Therefore, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he encouraged it. And that's why the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, a lot of them were very wealthy. They were successful businessmen. But what was the difference between us and them? The wealth of the Sahaba, it was something that they used to please Allah. They gave their wealth for the sake of Allah. They invested in the hereafter. It wasn't in their hearts, it was just in their hands. They possessed it in their hands, but they were not attached to it, right? Yes. They could live without it. And that's why they gave so much of it for the sake of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So that's what we need to teach ourselves, to have that understanding and that relationship with wealth, that it is not my source of happiness. Rather, I create my happiness by giving it away.
Subhanallah. By this.
The more I give it away, the happier I will be. The more I give for the sake of Allah, the more I invest in my hereafter, the more righteous deeds I do with it, the happier I will be. Allah will grant me more contentment because I'm investing in myself. When I give, I'm actually taking. People don't realize, but you're being very selfish when you're giving. Why? Because you're the first one who benefits from it. You benefit because by giving, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala purifies your soul. By giving, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala multiply your wealth. By giving, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala grant you blessings. By giving, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala pleased with you. By giving, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala protect you from calamities. By giving, Allah azza wa jal will be pleased with you. You're getting so much out of it. How can I not give?
Subhanallah.
Right? So the believer gives and is extremely generous. Naam.
Allahu Akbar. Just touch up on this. You know, a lot of the brothers, especially my age, slightly younger or a bit older, we are, you know, planning to get married. And we're finding it extremely difficult because of the situations nowadays with finances and mahr and so on and so forth. Can you advise us on what we can do to, number one, find a wife? And number two, what sort of mahr should someone be asking for from their potential
Mashallah,
husband?
MashaAllah, I was waiting for a marriage question to come up. I knew there was going to be at least one marriage question to come up, MashaAllah. Well, the first step that you need to take is that you need to follow the example of our dear brother Imran. Get up for Salat al-Layl. Pray tahajjud to Allah. Ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to grant you a righteous wife. That's the first step, right?
Yes.
Because whatever you ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, if you're serious about something, you get up for it at night and ask Allah. That's number one. When it comes to marriage is a responsibility, and no doubt the person who's going to get married, they need to be mature, they need to prepare themselves for that responsibility, right?
Yes.
You need to show a level of maturity, of responsibility. That's very important. Thirdly, when it comes to finances and so on, you strive, do what you can, get a job, work hard, take the responsibility, and do the best you can. And the other thing is that you must have full reliance upon Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. With marriage, Allah provide for you.
SubhanAllah.
Rather, Allah tells in the Quran, through marriage, Allah provides for you more. And if you ask anyone who got married, they tell you that I was granted a lot more wealth and provision after I got married compared to how I was before I got married. On top of that, you came to this world. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, before you came to this world, He recorded all your provision, the rizq that you're going to get, right?
Yes.
Tayyib, the person that you're going to marry, they came to this world and Allah recorded their provision. When they come into your life, they come with their rizq. So your rizq is doubled. When you have children, each child comes to this world with their rizq. Your rizq increases with every child that you have. That's where Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells, do not worry about the aspect. You work hard, you strive, you exert your efforts, and rely upon Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and call upon Allah and ask Allah to help you in that. It shouldn't be something that should stop you. When it comes to mahar and when it comes to how much the marriage and stuff should cost, people should try to make it simple and easy. They shouldn't complicate it. When families overcomplicate it and they request so much, they demand so much, that's against the sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ said, the less and that you spend and the more simple it is, the more barakah to have. Right,
yes.
The Prophet ﷺ told us that to have barakah. But when we go extravagant, we go overboard, and we go beyond our means, things we can't afford. I'm not saying go below your means. Within your means, what you're able to do, do it. Of course, everyone wants to honor their wife,
yeah,
and everyone wants to grant their spouse what they're able to do. But what you can't afford, and you go out to your budget, and you perhaps go into debt in order to get married, that doesn't make sense. Now,
SubhanAllah. While we're on the topic of marriage, Sheikh.
Hey, well, of course, the podcast now has changed into a marriage podcast. Of course, it would have.
You know, first happiness, then finance, inshallah. We're going somewhere with this.
MashaAllah.
So, while we're on the topic of marriage, I wanted to ask you, you know, in the Quran it says, وَخَلَقُنَاكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا, we're created in pairs.
Hey, well.
Now, nowadays, there's slight confusion with some communities. They are suggesting that, you know, you shouldn't be allowed to get married four times because you have a partner. How does that ideology work? What does that actually mean? And how can we understand it better?
وَخَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا, it means that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He created us in pairs.
Yes.
That pair, it doesn't necessarily mean any spouses and so on, right? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala created from Adam Hawa, right?
Okay.
Allah tabarak wa ta'ala created male and female.
Mm-hmm.
Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, all the animals, they have male and female. That's what it means, pairs, yani.
Okay.
It doesn't mean only one spouse.
Okay, so okay, cool.
It doesn't mean only one spouse.
So,
but
yeah,
of course, when we're talking about an individual getting married again and so on, it's based on ability. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says that if the individual is able to do so, and they're able to be just, and they're able to provide for all of them, then they can do that, and that's what's suggested, right? But if they're not able to do that, then don't take a responsibility that you can't take. Now,
SubhanAllah.
We'll take a pause.